want to introduce you to our panel, as we're calling them. And this is Danny Schaffner with the lead pastor at First Christian Church in Champaign. And I have Mike Yoder with us as well, and he is the senior pastor of the Vineyard in Urbana. And so thank you guys for coming. Really appreciate you being willing to do this. I think this is really going to bless our people today, and you guys are a blessing to be here. Mike, I've know you a little bit better than I know Danny. We've connected a couple of times. I've had leadership challenges and things that I've reached out to you and asked for your help, and you've been very gracious in that, and so appreciate that and your friendship. Danny, I don't know you as well, but we had lunch a couple of weeks back when going out to lunch was a thing. And but I just love the spirit of both your churches. What I know about both of you guys is that you're all about reaching your respective communities. And you've come up with some pretty creative ways to do that. I know, Danny, you have something, and I don't know how unique it is, but I've never heard of it before, and that you guys have an indoor playground and a track. And my wife used to actually go there. My kids were little and take advantage of that. And then, Mike, you guys reach your community through healing rooms and different things where you actually invite the community in, not just your own people, but the community in, and pray with people and minister to them. And that's just so powerful. In fact, we're looking to start something like that at Christian Life. And so your churches think outside the box. And there's so much uncertainty and fear going around. I want to highlight some of the positives that we need to look at. I know you guys are resourcing smaller churches and helping. So tell us some of the things that you're doing there, and then we'll go to Danny. I know you're leading, trying to lead some other churches and lead some things we can do to connect. And in fact, you got a conference call with several of us tomorrow. And so I want you to share that with us as well, if you would.
Yeah, I know. I think it's been great to see some of the opportunities that actually, like, just having these conversations has helped. Danny, you've sent numerous, or several emails that have been helpful. I forwarded on to people, say, hey, here's opportunities to help that maybe we weren't aware of that that had come to you and connected to us. And, our church has always been a church that's been part of our mission is to resource and connect other churches. That's part of who we are and what we love to do. But one of the ways that we realized we had some churches reach out, ask some questions, like, hey, we could easily just create a resource page with some of the things we already have available from a full service if it's needed that just kind of takes our branding off of it and they can utilize it as they want. Or hey, here's some worship sets. You know, we have the capability to record quality worship, and that's harder, especially for smaller churches who don't have that equipment to do. And so we just made some of those available online. We had churches in Mississippi who were using our stuff as a worship set. You know, they could record their message, but hey, we're just going to use this and plug that worship set into it. So that was another way that we were coming along and connecting. Just in this week, we were talking about some of the challenges of tech and doing church online, and we created a little message group. Some of the people on my team, I saw actually Barry, Eric, your creative lead was chatting with our guys about some of the challenges that they were facing and some of the ways that they were overcoming that. So yeah. Just really cool to, again, see how God is connecting churches and how we're willing to say, hey, let's all come together. We're all in this together. We don't have to be competitive. Yeah. We can actually do this better together.
Yeah, I think that's going to be really one of the positives that come out of this. The body of Christ is going to unite. Kind of have to. And so, Danny, like I said, you're kind of taking the lead in getting pastors together, talking about what we can do collectively. Share a little bit about what you got in mind there.
Yeah, it sounds more noble than when you say it your way. I think for me, I was just trying to say, hey, guys, we're friends. Let's work together. It's all God's kingdom. But I think churches can be like herding cats. You know, we can be very autonomous, go our own direction. And frankly, we just don't have space for that right now. We really have to be the kind of people that just say, whether we've had lunch once at El Toro in town or whether we've spent multiple days together, the reality is we need each other. We all need each other. And we want to see every community flourish, and we want to see the name of Jesus really get promoted through this, because we know that besides making sure that everybody gets a chance to gather on some level in their household to be a part of worship, what we really want to see advanced is the kingdom of God, where lives are changed and people are brought to Jesus.
That's exactly right. Yeah, I got a message from my brother, and so he's in Wichita, Kansas, and kind of last week found out may not be able to come into the office. So he messages me and says, hey, bro, you enjoying your time off? And so I put, yeah, right. You know, turns out he was serious. You know, he thought, but you guys both know whether you're home or not, we got more going on than we ever have. And one of the main things that we got to focus on right now is how to connect people. And so what ways are you coming up with to help people connect? Obviously, we really got to be thinking outside the box on this because we can't be together in person. So what? Whoever wants to address that one, please.
I'll start there. I'm sure you've got a lot of ideas off of this. I think first and foremost for us, we wanted to connect, make sure that we could connect in the worship experience itself. And so, like, we're a church that tends to take communion every week. And so we were doing things like, hey, make sure you've got crackers and juice. And because we believe that the church is a priesthood of believers, that it's all of us having a place of ministry, we're helping parents figure out, how do you have communion together with your kids? And what does that mean? And how do you lead with that? And so there's a connection that needs to happen in your home. But I have a men's group that I connect with on Monday nights, and we're all rough and tough and no emotions, and so we decided to do a Zoom face call, which is an online conference call, so to speak. And you have a gallery view where everybody can be seen. And there's about 12 of us in there. And here are these men, these grown men who, they're used to sitting in their, recliner, just, changing channels, waiting for the next football highlight. And I've got guys texting me going, it was so good to talk. It was so good. And I'm like, I haven't changed anything, but the connection was so needed that we've tried to do that, because a phone call is nice, email's okay, text is kind of different, but if the face-to-face is really what's being missed. And so we've started to try and provide our group some opportunity to at least be face-to-face the best we can. And those are probably two things, just simple things that we've tried to do.
Yeah, very cool. And that's neat, guys are connecting. But You take away sports, what else are we going to do, right?
That's very true. I think some of those things are really good. It's there's the online communities that we're all being challenged to kind of foster in new ways, and I think some of those are good challenges. They're coming at a hard time, but they're good challenges that we all need to face as the church, because this is where things have been going for a long time, is how to do that well. And then we're also looking at when we can meet together, the reality is we all need groups of people that we can connect with. And so we're really encouraging our small groups, trying to give them tools, tutorials, how to get online, how to do video chat, how to do some of the video message chats, just so there is some aspect of that face-to-face. And I know that especially with some of our singles in our community, where they, we might all be at home with kids and going, like, I could use a little bit of more social distancing from our kids, but for those who aren't with that, who are completely alone right now, I think that's a real challenge. And so providing places where we can connect, help them connect. One of the things I think that's interesting is part of this is forcing us to engage with some of the tools, social media, and learning how to do it in a healthy way, which has been a challenge for many people. I know parents have been, how do we engage with social media in a healthy way? How do we engage with the online world? And in some ways, this is going to force the church to grow up and learn some of those skills. And so our hope is that those can be some of the redeeming things that can come out of all of this, is learning how to handle that well as the church.
Yeah, that's so good. I think one of the real neat things that we've seen, and really why I wanted to do this, is because as we have this discussion, I know right now it's sparking ideas among our people. Because the reality is, you and your team and me and my team, we can come up with ideas, but we're never going to come up with as many ideas, and sometimes even as good of ideas, as the people out there. Like, for example, we got people, they were so desperate just to reach out and encourage people, that this Sunday, after we did the live stream, they went driving around in what they called a quarantine parade. And so, like, on our street, we have four people that go to Christian Life on our block. And so they called us, said, hey, be looking out your window. So we did. And they're driving by, beeping, yelling love you, signs out the window, playing music. And just really cool. I think we had five cars in the line. And so are your people beginning to find more and more creative ways to connect as well?
Yeah, actually, that made me reminded me. So we have a campus in Sullivan, Illinois as well. And one of our pastors on staff there, she's an amazing cook. And is, every time she does the meal, everybody's like, you'll get, your attendance will spike, by 50%. But one of the creative ways that she did is that she's at home and she doesn't have, she has her kids older, and so it's just her and her husband. But she started making little cookie kits with like six cookies in a packet with some icing and some things for decorating. She made these little decorating kits, and she's like, she just put it out on Facebook. Hey, anybody in town that wants to come and pick these up, I'll put them out on the porch. You can come pick some up. And they were like gone, like immediately. And so just creative little ways that people were saying, hey, here's some things you can do with your family, with your kids, and I can help with that. So it was just a really cool way, I thought, to connect people in different ways. And just creative. Like, I would never do that. One, because I can't bake any cookies and nobody would want to pick them off my porch. So maybe the raccoons, I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. We just start spurring the stuff on and it's going to come up with more and more ideas. But people are going to connect. They're not going to keep the body of Christ from remaining disconnected. It's just not going to happen. So, yeah, that's so good. What would you guys say you're finding to be your biggest challenge in leading your churches through this season of really unprecedented uncertainty, at least unprecedented in our lifetime?
You know, I think because it's so unprecedented, there's a lack of resources and lack of wisdom of people who have had success. And so on one hand, it's providing a great entrepreneurial spirit where we can kind of throw something against the wall, and if it works, great. And if it doesn't, everybody's just kind of given grace. But when you think about the impending moments that could be coming, you know, we told our staff, first and foremost, told them a couple things. One, you know, we use the old airline illustration. You know, if something happens in flight, put your mask on first. Make sure you've got things at home and work. Get those things in place. We're going to make sure our church is in place before we try and save and fix everything else. We've kind of done that now. But the next thing is then, now how are we going to respond? We can't afford to react. We know this is coming. So what needs to be our fingerprint on this? And so, you know, trying to figure out, is it the elderly in our community? Do we need to adopt specifically nursing homes or retirement villages? Do we need to figure out an elementary school that we're partnered with? Do we need to prepare for food relief? Trying to figure out the truth, and this is what's hard for me, is every one of those needs is essential. Which one is our church going to say, that's the thumbprint we're going to do because we feel like that's the most appropriate for us, that's what's going to engage the our church as far as movement and is going to address a very specific need that's true to our culture and our community? I would say that's the things that probably are on our heart and mind a lot right now.
Yeah, and I think that's what's so helpful about you getting together with pastors tomorrow and beginning conversations like that, because if we're all meeting the exact same needs and other needs are going unmet, and what good is that going to accomplish? So I like the way you're thinking with that. Mike, what biggest challenge for you?
Yeah, I think what Danny spoke to is one of the major challenges, just kind of what are the needs that are going to be facing. I think really it's thinking on a more macro level, it's really this fear of the unknown, this place of unknown that lives out there for people. And, you know, we often are talking and pastoring people through that idea that the unknown is always so much bigger than what we know and always feels so much bigger. And so when there's fear is trying to associate with that, man, it can really put people into a place of panic. And really, this is a time for the church to shine, to come forward, because we don't serve a God who's unknown. We serve a God who's made himself very known to us, and he knows what we need to face. He knows the ways he wants us to partner with him. But if we're in a state of letting fear grip us, which we know does not come from God, that spirit of fear is definitely not from God. When we let that, we can't be in a place where we're ready to actually go and address those needs of the community, address the needs that are going to be facing us in the next 2, 3 weeks, months, you know, ahead. We need to be in a place where, like, look, we are carriers of good news. And what we bring to the community in this time is hope. It's a place where anxiety doesn't live, where we're not in a place of panic, where we can face these things because we know who we serve and we know that he's already got a plan. We just get to partner with him. But we have to be a place as the church ready to face those challenges that Danny mentioned in our community and do it in a way and in a mindset that isn't filled with fear. And I think that's that unknown piece of kind of pushing back that fear of the unknown. We don't have to know everything. That's what faith exists for. We get to have faith in a God who cares. And so if we can push that back, then we can address those places of challenge that are really going to come at us.
That's exactly right. Good stuff. And in the same way that the fear is not of the Lord, coronavirus isn't of the Lord. Yeah. But he makes all things work for good for those who love him and call according to his purpose. And so I think that's one of the most exciting things. After everything's done, and we'll get through this, we don't know what the devastation will be to the economy and everything else, but we will get through it. And on the other side, what are going to be some of the permanent changes, the positive permanent changes? I think there's really going to be a lot of them. So that kind of leads me into, I just got a couple more things I want to talk to you guys about. And the next is, you know, you guys have had some time to think about this by this point, and we know God's up to something. He doesn't waste pain, and he somehow is going to turn this for good. What do you think he's up to?
Well, I think there's a couple of things. I think when I think about the movement of God, there's kind of a few buttons that he likes to push. One is pause, and I think that's happening already. Let's just stop. Let's just settle down and let's just rest in him. The second button is often reset. And I think a lot of people right now are looking at their checkbook. I think they're looking at their calendar. I think they're looking at their household and they're going, I've talked about New Year's resolutions. I've talked about change that needs to happen in my life. Change is going to happen in my life whether I'm ready or not. So let's reset this with God. God, I hear you. I certainly hear you now. So I want to reset. And I think the third button he pushes is respond. And I think what's going to happen is a greater, more acute awareness that when God is at work, whether in crisis or calling, that we are available in both. And I just think we're at a point right now where the church is just saying, hey, you know what? We're asking each other, how do we best do this? What are you doing? How are you figuring this out? What are your people needing? And we're sitting in a humble posture before God and each other. And frankly, that doesn't always happen with churches. And I've been guilty of that. That resembles me in a lot of ways. And so I think that what's happening is kind of a renewal before God and a revival towards God, where there's a repentance and a change that's happening as he's determining which buttons to push when. And God's always been at work. He's always been at work. He's still at work. And he wasn't surprised by this. He was known through this, and he is still moving and preparing for us to join him in what's happening right now.
Yeah, that's just great, great insight. Thank you.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right, Danny. And I think, you know, what I'm sensing too is, you know, God is, he's teaching us what it really means to have faith that moves mountains. You know, I've heard this described as a storm too. You know, often, like, what are we going to do with the storm of coronavirus? What did Jesus do in the storm, right? He spoke peace to the storm. He took authority over those things that would come against who he was. And so we get to live in that same and greater works as he did. We get to be in that place where we get to speak peace to the storm. We get to have the faith, you know, to say, keep our eyes on Jesus and to step out of the boat. You know, and I think that's hard because it's easy to want to say, you know what, I'm going to hole up right here in the boat, you know, just like I'm holding up at home. And it's easy to live in that place. But, and this doesn't mean that we're not going to use wisdom. I think we want to take this very seriously and the health of others. And we love our neighbors by distancing ourselves from them at this time, you know, in a physical way in order to do that and to honor the leadership of communities and health organizations that are doing that. But I actually think God's preparing us for a revival that he's bringing. I think he's preparing us for a harvest of souls who are going to be more open to him than they've ever been for years. And I think it's our opportunity now to step forward and learn this lesson of loving our neighbors well. That's actually going to put us in a place where we get to participate in what he's doing next. Because I think there is a big move of God that's coming. Because whenever the enemy brings something this big against us and against the church, you know God wants to redeem that for amazing blessings bigger than what the enemy brought. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Of course, we have to respond, right?
Yeah.
But so far early on, what I'm seeing is we are. You know, I really think the church is stepping up. I really think God has people's attention. When I'm seeing attendance numbers higher online than when we had the physical building open, and, you know, talking to you guys before we started this, you guys are seeing the same thing. That means that God is moving and doing some things and getting people's attention. I agree with a lot of things you guys just said. Mike, as it relates to revival, I so believe we are on the cusp of that. I told the church Sunday that what I think God is doing is removing our idols. You know, you can't go out to eat. You can't go to watch sports, right? And so we've just had all of our entertainment stripped away. You can't go to the movies. And I think God is saying, look, because if revival is going to happen, church has to repent. It doesn't start unless the church repents. And so I think he's bringing us and giving us an opportunity to just get on our face before him. And what else are you going to do? Most people can't go to work anymore. So it's just really an opportunity to dig into the things of God and kind of hit that reset that you talked about, Danny. I love that. All right. This is how I would like to close. Well, actually, I want to close with having you guys pray for our people. But before we do that, I'd love for you to just look into that camera right there. And whoever wants to go first is fine. And what do you think God's word for our church is right now? I know you guys are men who hear from God. What do you think God would say to Christian life right now in this season we're going through? You're nodding a lot, so we'll start with you, Mike.
I was thinking about this, one, I just want to reaffirm what you said about that God removed my idols. That's exactly the conversations we were having this week, and some of the messages we're preparing for our church was exactly that thing of God removing a place of idols. And so I'm just speaking in affirmation and confirmation of what you're hearing there. But I actually just felt like as I was, I prayed about this a little bit and was thinking about kind of what God has to share. And I actually felt like he asked to share some of the same things that I've been sharing with our church and some of the things, some words that God spoke over our church. Because I do think God's doing something. And at the beginning of this year, actually before any of this happened, God gave us the word for our church that was humility and unity. And those were the words he said over the church. This was back in January. We actually spoke this out over our leadership teams, and we've been speaking it with our teams at church and the congregation. And, you know, like you said, whether you want to be in a season of fasting or taking away right now, we're forced to be in that season of things having to kind of be stripped away. And if there's ever a time for unity, it's now. And actually, this was the verse, and I wanted to actually read this. I felt like I was supposed to read these verses to you. This is Philippians 2, 3 through 5. And this is actually from the Passion Translation, just because I feel like this translation captures so well the heart and understanding. It's Philippians 2, 3 through 5. It says, be free from pride-filled opinions, for they will only harm your cherished unity. Don't allow self-promotion to hide in your hearts, but in authentic humility, put others first. View others as more important than yourself. Abandon every display of selfishness. Possess a greater concern for what matters to others instead of your own interest. And consider the example that Jesus, the Anointed One, has set before us. Let his mindset become your motivation. I just love this. This set aside, you know, pride, set aside all of those things. Let humility protect your unity. How much more do we need unity in this season is right now? And this idea that we're protecting this in this age of social distancing, we need this unity. God was speaking this unity word over and over and over again. And then this humility piece that, you know, over and over in the Bible, we see that when God's people would humble themselves, it left room for God to move. It allowed God to move. When we were able to humble ourselves, to set aside idols, to set aside things that we don't need anymore, that's where he wanted to move. And this idea that we abandon every display of selfishness, that is so counterculture to the world right now. The world says hoard, and God says be generous. God says be radically generous. See, God placed you in this time, in this challenge, as the church, because he equipped you to be victorious in the season. He equipped you to overcome it. He actually sent you as the solution to the crisis that we're facing right now. That's who he sent you to as the church. So let his mindset become your motivation, and we will see the revival that God wants to bring to our land.
You know, part of what's going on in my own journey right now is I'm resetting some of my prayer posture and walking through that a little bit. Pastor Ricky Spindler at Stone Creek had reached out to me and had given me a book, How to Pray, and by Pete Gregg, I think it is, a leader from England. And I'm just in a few chapters of it, and I've just been wrestling with this this idea of just simply pray. And what profoundly hit me recently was that prayer is something that whether you believe in God or not, people will often revert to in things of crisis. And so, you know, my word is just real simple. It's we always need to be prepared to give an answer for the hope that we have in Jesus. We get that. We want to be prepared. But there are people who I think are curious and wrestling with, what can I grab hold of right now? And prayer, I think, is that piece. I think we start telling people that God has shoulders big enough that your fear and your anger and your doubt and your criticism and the baggage, God can carry that. And it, so let's just be the kind of people that are genuine and authentic, and let's just have it out in front of God. Let's just say, God, this is where I'm stuck. This is where I'm frustrated, because I believe that God is known, God is personal, and there are people sitting next to us and around us that are just trying to say, how do I do this? And we know it's not a magic formula. You know, it's not, we don't rub the lucky rabbit's foot or the genie's. We just, in times of need, we share what we can. And when we can't, the Holy Spirit has the ability to work in us and through us. And I just think we're at a point where if we would begin to pray, and I literally just mean to put to thought and expression the emotion that we have in our life before God and let it go. Let just put it in front of God. I think there's going to begin to be some honest interaction with our Heavenly Father in ways that people could not comprehend or did not understand. And I think that's for those of us who have a relationship with God to begin to live that out. But also those around us who don't have a relationship with God to say, come on in. You don't have to, but let's just start to talk before God. Let's just start to put the words to what God may be stirring up in us. And I think what you're going to find is a curiosity that becomes contagious amongst the church. And people are just going to say, hey, here I am. I don't know much about this, but I hear about your Jesus. I've seen your church at work. I know when everybody else and every other non-for-profit could have stepped up, it was the church making real change. That's what I want to do. That's who I want to be. Help me.
And Lord forbid that's not what happens. But we are we're already seeing it happen. So I know that the church is going to respond, is responding. I just so much affirmation and confirmation and what you guys just said. You talked about words at the beginning of the year, Mike, and you talked about prayer. Well, one of our words was prayer. And so I felt like the Lord gave me three words: prayer, righteousness, and joy. And so prayer, you know, that's self-explanatory. We started the year with 40 days of prayer. And in fact, we're starting again Thursday. I believe we're getting called back into that season again. We're going to do it online, the devotion in the morning, celebrate communion. I liked what you had to say about communion, Danny. And so we're going to be doing that as well. Righteousness is a time to get back to God, and it's a time to get right with God, and it's time that we cast out these idols. And then the joy, you know, sorrow comes for a night, but joy comes in the morning. And so lots of good things coming for the church. I really believe that. I really believe that. Close us out with a prayer, each of you, for our people, if you would, and then I'll pray for you and we'll close.
God, we just stop for a moment and we breathe you in. God, we're reminded that every breath in our life comes from you. God, the very fact that we're sitting in this curious and crisis and whatever this moment may be, God, we need to be reminded that you are very present and you are with us. God, our hearts are anxious. Our minds are confused. So God, we would ask that your Holy Spirit would bring a peace that passes all understanding, that you would give us comfort in the way that only you can. God, there is a work that needs to happen in us and through us. But God, let it not just be with us. Let it not just be individual. Let it be something that begins to bond us to our neighbor, to our friend, to our enemy. God, may we be the kind of people that as we recognize every relationship around us, that reconciliation becomes the tip of our tongue, that we would have right relationship with you, and that we would reconcile the relationship that we have with others. God, our heart is that you would be glorified. Our mind is that you would move in an intentional and strategic way to bring all people to you. And so God, move our feet, extend our hands, open our eyes, but move us to join you where you're at work. God, we're so thankful for the work of Jesus, the example that he set for us. But God, even more so, God, may we be the presence of Jesus. May we be the body of Christ as the local church. And may the world that does not know you, may they recognize your fingerprints all over this moment and all over our community. It's in his name we pray.
Yeah, Father, we just thank you. We thank you that you are the God who said you'll never leave us and you'll never forsake us. That we can trust that even in the midst of crisis, you are calm. You are a bringer of peace, and that your peace can rule over our fear. Your joy can rule over our anxiety. That you can help us to be a people of hope in a time of despair. And so God, I just speak right now that your people, would they just be a people who exemplify your love, that they show the world what it means to bring the good news of who you are and what you've done. And that in the midst of a crisis here on earth, God, that we can be a people that can bring heaven solutions right here to earth in everything that we do. God, that this would be a time for your church not to shrink, but instead to grow. To grow in its understanding of how to partner with you, how to listen to you, how to have faith in you beyond all of our circumstances, God. And I thank you that right here in this place and wherever people are listening right now, God, that they can know that they are filled with your Spirit, that they are workers of miracles wherever that they are at, that they can hear from you, that they can minister to you as the church, no matter where we're scattered, we are united as one. Thank you in Jesus' name.
Lord. Father, I know these guys are busy and have other things they could be doing in this time of crisis. And Father, for them to sacrifice their time and just come and encourage our people today, I'm so thankful for that. God, would you just bless them abundantly. Father, bless their leadership, bless their families, bless their churches, God, bless their people, bless their communities. God, we know that what the enemy is intended for evil, you mean for good. And so, God, we believe you're going to take this crisis situation and somehow this is all going to work out and we're going to be better as a result for it. And so, God, would you just encourage our people? God, would you just encourage the members of the Vineyard, the members of First Christian Church? The reality is, God, I do believe that revival is coming, and I believe it's bigger than any one church. God, I believe nationwide type revival is coming, but I believe specifically in Central Illinois, God, you're going to do things throughout Urbana and Champaign and even here in Little Rantoul. And God, I believe you're using our churches for that. And I just thank you and I just praise you. God, just bless us and help us to have a wonderful week as we kick off some brand new initiatives this week, because I know all our churches are. We give you all the glory, honor, and praise. It's in Jesus' name. Amen.